Good morning, children. This is your social science class. So today we are going to discuss unit 2 in geography, lithosphere, second portion, exogenetic processes. So this is what we are going to see. Lithosphere, it is outer part of the earth, and the second portion only we are going to see now. And exogenetic process, which means that is formed under the surface of the earth. So what are the processes going on under the earth? So this is what we are going to see in this chapter. The earth is a dynamic system that undergoes various changes due to internal and external processes. So it is, our earth is a dynamic system. It has gone many changes, and it's keep on going, and it is keep on changing its outer layer or inner layer, whatever it is. So due to internal and external process, many changes occurs. The external processes are the consequences of solar energy and gravitational forces, whereas the internal processes are the outcome of Earth's internal heat. So when it happens externally, this is a consequence of solar energy and gravitational forces. When it is occurring out external, the processes are the outcome of Earth's internal heat. Okay, this is what. Okay, now we'll see about weathering and its types. Weathering is a disintegration and decomposition of materials of earth's crust by their exposure to atmosphere. So weathering is nothing but it is a disintegration and decomposition of various materials of the earth's crust. Okay, so by their exposure to atmosphere, when it's exposed to the atmosphere, it happens. Movement of huge volumes of weathered rock material down and the slope due to gravity is called mass movement or mass wastage. So movement of huge volumes of weathered rock material, okay, when it is very big, it used to move, right? And due to gravity is called mass wastage. The nature and magnitude of weathering differs from place to place and region to region. So the nature of weathering, it always differs, right? So from place to place, from region to region, so it differs. There are three types of weathering, that is physical weathering, chemical weathering and biological weathering. So let us see that in detail. First we'll see about physical weathering. It is a breakdown of rocks without changing their chemical composition through the action of physical forces. So physical weathering is nothing but breakdown of rocks. The rocks are breaking down without any reaction, any chemical composition changes, that is called physical weathering. Exfoliation, block disintegration, granular disintegration are the different types of weathering. So we have three types: exfoliation, block disintegration, granular disintegration. Okay, first we'll see about exfoliation. The alternate cooling and heating on rounded rock surfaces lead to the peeling of rocks layer by layer. This is called exfoliation. So the alternate heating, once it will be heated, once it is cooled, so on the rounder rock surfaces it will be peeling like onion. When it keep on peeling, nothing will be there, no, will be peeling, keep on peeling. So like this layer by layer it get peeled. This is called exfoliation. Next we'll see about the granular disintegration. Granular disintegration take place in crystalline rocks where the grains of rocks become loose and fall out. So here it occurs in crystalline rocks, okay, the rocks will become loose and sometimes it will fall out. That is called granular disintegration. Next, block disintegration. So this disintegration is caused due to repeated expansion and contraction of rocks day and night. So repeated things happening, this block integration is caused. Next we'll see about chemical weathering. Disintegration and decomposition of rocks due to chemical reaction is called chemical weathering. So decomposition of rocks due to chemical reactions. So in everything chemical reaction would occur, right? So in rocks also, decomposition of rocks due to chemical reaction it occurs, and that is called chemical weathering. Chemical weathering take place through the process of oxidation, carbonation, solution and hydration. So these are the processes included in chemical weathering. So now we'll see about oxidation. Oxygen in the atmosphere reacts with the iron found in rocks, forming iron oxide. This form is called oxidation. So oxygen in the atmosphere, it will react with the rock, iron found in the rocks, iron, okay. So it will react with iron found in the rock, and this process is known as oxidation. It will be forming iron oxide. Okay. Carbonation is the mixing of water with the atmospheric carbon dioxide forming carbonic acid. So carbonation is nothing but mixing of water with the atmospheric carbon dioxide. Okay, solution is a process of dissolution of rock substances in water. So it is a solution is nothing but dissolution of rock. Okay, this results in the loosening of rock particles. Sometimes no rocks all will lose all the power, many sands and soil will be coming out. So this is called solution. Certain chemicals in the rock enlarge in size in humid conditions, resulting in the development of cracks and rock wears down. This is not hydration. So when certain chemicals the rocks and all will become enlarged in size due to the humid conditions. Okay, some wet thing in the air, wind, okay, that occurs, and this is known as hydration. Next we'll see about biological weathering. Biological weathering occurs due to the penetration and expansion of plant roots, earthworms, burrowing animals like rabbits, rats, and some human activities. So these all occur due to burrowing. Okay, some animals would burrow some rocks, and all it will burrow some rocks, rabbits, rats, and even human also, they burrow for few things, right? So human activities make all these things, and earthworms, plant also, some plants, it will be rooted very deeply. Have you ever noticed, children, in the rock also many strong and big trees would have been grown? So the roots and all, it has been planted in a very deep condition. So that is called biological weathering. Next we'll see about erosional landforms formed by underground water. Erosional landforms formed by underground water because most of the erosion take place due to the process of solution. So solution is dissolution of rock substances, right? So most of this erosion take place due to this. When rainwater mixes with carbon dioxide and enters into limestone region, it dissolves and destroys much of the limestone. So when rainwater, when it is mixed with carbon dioxide and enters into the limestone region, okay, the rock. So this it dissolve and destroys the limestone which is in there. As a result, landforms such as Terra rosa, lapis, sinkholes, swallow holes, dolines, ovalas, poilges, caves and caverns are formed. So these are the landforms are formed due to that destruction of this limestone. Okay, first we'll see about Terra rosa. Deposition of red clay soil on the surface of the earth is due to the dissolution of limestone content in rocks. So deposition of red clay soil. So Terra rosa, it is an Italian term for red soil. So deposition of red clay soil on the surface of the earth is called Terra rosa. It occurs due to the dissolution of limestone. Okay, when the limestone get dissolved, this red soil will get deposited on the surface of the earth. Next we'll see about lapis. When the joints of limestone are corrugated by groundwater, long furrows are formed. So when the joints of limestone rocks are folded by the groundwater, long furrows, which means long lines, are formed. That is all called lapis. Next we'll see about sinkholes. A funnel shaped depressions formed due to dissolution of limestone rock is called sinkholes. A funnel shaped, have you seen a funnel, children? So this sinkhole is like funnel shaped depression that is formed due to the dissolution of limestone. Next we'll see about caves. So these caves are formed by the dissolution of limestone when carbon dioxide in air turns into carbonic acid. Caverns are the caves with irregular floors. So caves, these are formed by the dissolution of limestone. So all these occur because of the solving of limestones, okay, which is a very important thing for the rock. So now we'll see about glaciers. A glacier is a large mass of ice that moves slowly over the land from its place of accumulation. It is also known as river of ice. So glacier is a large mass, it's not a small cube, ice cube. It is a large mass of ice that moves very slowly from one place to another, from its place of origin to another place. It is also known as river of ice, but this moving, it will be very slow. The place of accumulation is called snowfield. So that is called snowfield, from the where the place is accumulated. which means gathered together. So that place is called Snowfield. The height above which there is a permanent snow cover in the higher altitude or latitude is called snow line. So the height above where the snow is covered in a high latitude, that is called snow line. The gradual transformation of snow into granular ice is called firn or neve, or finally it becomes solid glacial ice. So the gradual transformation of snow into ice, granular ice. So it will be very big in size at the beginning, but later it will be gradually transforming into some granules, some small particles. So that is called firn or neve, and finally it becomes solid glacial ice. The large mass of ice creates pressure at its bottom and generates heat. Due to this, the glacier melts a little and starts to move. So the large mass of ice, no, due to its pressure, it generates heat. So due to this heat, no, little bit it started to melt and started to move from its place, from its accumulation place, right? Now we'll see about the types of glaciers. Glaciers are broadly divided into two types of the place of occurrence, such as continental glacier, valley glaciers. So it is divided into two types: continental glaciers, valley glaciers. Thick sheets of ice that covers vast area of a continent is called continental glacier. So it will be like thick sheet that covers a very big area is called continental glaciers. Valley glaciers, the glaciers which takes its origin from a snow covered with mountain range is called valley glacier. So the glacier which takes its origin from the beginning, the snow covered with a mountain range is called valley glacier. So these are the two types of glaciers. Next we'll see about the depositional work of winds. So how wind is getting deposited, will it deposit, we'll see that. Depositional landforms of wind. Deposition occurs when the speed of wind is reduced by the presence of obstacles like bushes, forest and rock structures. So the speed of the wind is also getting reduced by these reasons, like bushes, very strong bushes means the air could not blow in a very big speed, okay, very fast. Forest and rock structures, so that will all block its flow. The sediments carried by wind get deposited on both the windward and leeward sides of these obstacles. So the sediments carried by the wind are deposited. Now we'll see about sand dunes. In deserts during sandstorms, wind carries lot of sand. When the speed of wind decreases, huge amount of sand get deposited. These hills of sands are called sand dunes. So in desert and all, no, sandstorms would occur. Okay, that time very too much of sand, loads of sand will be carried. So when the speed of the sand wind decreases, some amount, a huge amount of sand would be deposited in one place. So that is called sand dunes. Next we'll see about barchans. Barchans are isolated crescent shaped sand dunes. They have gentle slopes on the windward side and steep slopes on the leeward side. So these are the sand dunes that is very isolated crescent shaped. Okay, they have a very gentle slope on the windward side. Next we'll see about transverse dunes. They are asymmetrical in shape. They are formed by alternate slow and fast winds that blow from the same direction. So they don't have a exact symmetrical shape. Okay, one side will be very big, one side will be very short. So asymmetrical in shape. They are formed by the alternate slow and fast winds. Okay, fast and slow winds that blow from the same direction. So that is called transverse dunes. Next we'll see about longitudinal dunes. Longitudinal dunes are the long narrow ridges of sand which extend in direction parallel to prevailing winds. So these are the dunes that are very long narrow ridges of sand. Okay, next we'll see about loess. The term loess refers to the deposit of sand over a vast region. So this loess, no, it refers to the deposit of fine sand over a vast region. So for a very vast big region, the sand is getting deposited. Extensive loess deposits are found in northern western China, pampas of Argentina, Ukraine, Mississippi valleys of the United States. So these are the places where the extensive loess deposits. Okay. Now we'll see about the three orders of landforms. First order of landform is, it includes the continents, ocean, basis on the comprise the largest units of the earth's relief. So the first order, it includes continents and ocean. The second order, it includes mountain belts, plateaus and plains. Now the third order of landforms, it includes hills, valleys, mountains. The third order of landforms are shaped by the external or exogenic earth processes. So this is what we have learned in this chapter, children. We'll do a short recap. A leveling of uneven landform is called gradation. Weathering is a breaking down of the rock. Physical, chemical and biological are the three types of weathering. Running water, glacier, underground water, wind and waves are the agents of weathering. So these are the agents of weathering. Soil is weathered materials covering the earth's surface. Okay. So we'll get the notes also. Once you get doubt, just rewind this video and audio visual. Okay. So one or two times when you hear all this, you'll get to know it clearly. Thank you.